Today we will look at metal gate transistors. You know, you may recall that the very abbreviation MOSFET, M here really stands for metal, because that is how we sort of started building FETs, right? In the very beginning, the FETs that we used to build had metal gates, okay, but the metal gate was due to certain constraints. We were not able to really do what we call in the recent past polysilicon gate transistor, and hence we were building metal gate transistors. So when we were building these metal gate field effect transistor way back in you know 60s and you know maybe 70s, the problem with the metal gate was the following, right? The metal gate transistor was not a self-aligned transistor. Okay. So what I mean by the self-alignment is that if you recall the MOSFET flow that we have discussed in one of our earlier lectures, if you recall, I had mentioned that in polysilicon gate transistors that we have today, okay, we have this gate stack which includes the SiO2 or of course high K now, and polysilicon, and here you do ion implantation, right? You convert you know polysilicon into N plus or P plus. That is how you make it a very highly doped polysilicon material, and that is done along with the source drain implant, correct? You see, polysilicon was deposited as intrinsic polysilicon, but subsequently if it were to be NMOS region, I implant arsenic, and the arsenic will sort of come in here, right? This would have been a P-well region for a N-channel transistor, and arsenic would have also come in here, and in this region arsenic would have come in and stuck in the gate region, right? That is how I would have converted that gate into a N plus doped region. Now notice here that when you are done with all these junctions, you see the junction is sort of self aligned to the edge of the gate, okay, and of course subsequently there is going to be some annealing process, and because of the annealing these dopants will diffuse in and also diffuse a little bit inside laterally, but they are more or less aligned to the edge of the gate. You do not want to have a unaligned, or you know, a transistor where gate does not overlap source and drain. You know, it is okay as long as gate is right edge on with source and drain, but of course you do not want to have a transistor structure which looks something like this. You know, that would be suicidal for transistor, right? If let us say if this is your gate and this is your SiO2 and only N plus region is here, N plus region is here, this is all P region, when you are trying to do this, you somehow ended up with this region which we sometimes call underlap, as opposed to having something like this, where source and drain are actually going beyond the gate edge, okay. This region is what we call overlap, okay. If you have underlap where you know gate does not cover some regions of the transistor, as a result of that you would not be able to create an inversion channel here, your transistor will not be conducting, it would not be a good transistor. So this is certainly a no-no, correct? You should never have this. Okay, you should either have an edge on, which is good, because you know right now here you have junctions and immediately this region can be inverted by the gate, because the gate field is influencing your channel region, right? This is ideal, okay, but it is okay if you have little bit of overlap, but not, well, if you have too much of overlap, is there an issue? Well, there is an issue, and that is to do with the parasitic capacitance issue. Okay. This issue here is with respect to parasitic resistance. You know, this is a region where you will not be able to turn on the transistor, huge resistance for the transistor. Okay. Whereas here, what would happen is that if you were to look at this transistor, we call this overlap capacitance. You see, here is J and here is D and here is S. You have these overlap undesired capacitance called CGD and CGS. Okay, and sometimes these are also called as Miller capacitances. Okay, that is essentially a capacitance between your gate and the drain. Okay, especially typically source is at ground potential, let's say for a transistor, but especially when you want to use a transistor as an amplifier, your gate to drain parasitic capacitance should not be too high. Okay, that will in turn impact the bandwidth of the transistor. In other words, you see a schematic representation of transistor in a circuit is like this, right? G, D and S. Let's say I'm building an amplifier. This parasitic capacitance from input to the output of the transistor, that's not good. So ideally a zero overlap is best you can get, but it may be very difficult to get. So you are okay if you can't get zero, at least you can get something, you know, non-zero positive, but certainly not negative. What happened with the metal gate? The very reason why we moved from metal gate transistors to polysilicon gate transistors was that the metal gate transistor invariably resulted in huge overlap here. Okay, so if you were to compare your metal gate versus metal gate that we used to do in the past, okay, early days of the transistor technology, your metal gate transistor invariably looked something like this. You had this gate, let's say metal gate, and a huge overlap, but still a working transistor. There is a parasitic capacitance, all right. Okay, right. And on the other hand, if it is a poly gate transistor, you get almost an ideal transistor structure, just maybe a little bit of overlap here. Okay, because of the self-aligned nature. So what is not self-aligned here? You see, if you are doing the metal gate transistor, first of all, it turns out you cannot do source and drain implant after patterning your gate. You see, let's say that I am putting aluminum here. Let's recall our transistor process flow. In a poly gate transistor, I first make the gate stack, right? This oxide and polysilicon gate is made and implantation of arsenic. After implantation, invariably I will have to anneal at high temperature, typically 1000 degrees centigrade. If you were to do the same thing here, what would happen? At 1000 degrees, aluminum will melt. Aluminum cannot withstand that high temperature. Even at 550, it will start melting. Okay. So most of the metals that you know you would want to use as gate materials, they would melt at temperatures which are used to anneal the source drain implantation. And hence, in a metal gate transistor, okay, you do what is called source drain first and gate last process, as opposed to here in a polysilicon gate transistor, you do gate first. Hence, you have defined the gate stack, you see, and hence I do not need anything else to define my source drain, because it is going to be self aligned, right? Source and drain last. In this process, if you are doing source and drain first and gate last, you have already defined the junctions, correct? And then you grow the gate oxide. The process flow here will look something like this. Junctions are defined, gate oxide is grown, gate electrode is deposited, which is metal, which is everywhere, and now all the gates are shorted, right? I need a photolithography step to pattern the gate. Okay, and that photolithography step should be aligned with already defined source drain junction. So I am depending on a photolithography step to do the alignment. Okay, so what I do in order to avoid an underlap situation, because when you are trying to align something which is already printed, there could be an offset, you see. In order to avoid an offset, you build in an extra margin. Even if there is an offset, you still get a working transistor which does not look like this, right. So, as a result of that, you do the patterning. When you do the patterning, you give an extra margin. You actually pattern a wider, a longer gate than that is required just to cover the source drain area. So, that even if this gate shifts a little bit to the left, you know, you still have an overlap here. Even if it shifts to the right, you still have an overlap here. So, by giving an intentional margin, okay, I am going to get a working transistor, because that is the first thing, right, and then you worry about all parasitics. So, the metal gate transistors always have the large overlap of gate over source and drain, and hence that is not a desirable thing, okay. This was one problem. Okay, the other problem with the metal gate transistor, you know, is also that you have a one metal to all transistors. It is the same metal for N channel, same metal for P channel, let us say. Then the work function of the metal is fixed, you see. Whereas, in case of a polysilicon gate transistor, your work function for NMOS transistor is closer to the conduction band, because it is N plus. And your work function for PMOS transistor is closer to the valence band. Now, why is it that important? It is very important because in order to get symmetric VTs, for N and P, okay. Recall what is the VT equation? Your VT is VFB plus 2 phi B plus QD by C aux, let us say. Okay, right. VFB, ignoring all charges in the oxide, this is essentially phi ms, which is work function difference, right, which is phi ms plus 2 phi b plus QD by C aux. For polysilicon gate technology, what happens? For NMOS, I have N plus gate, okay. N plus gate meaning on the gate, the Fermi level is very close to the conduction band edge, okay. So, what is phi ms as a result of that? Phi ms is negative in N channel transistor. Remember that you have a vacuum level and this is a conduction band level on the gate. So, this is 4.05 electron volt, which is electron affinity, and your substrate is a p type. So, where Fermi level is below the mid gap. Okay, so, work function on the P side is much larger. So, phi m minus phi s gives a negative quantity, and in fact, phi m minus phi s is half the band gap plus phi b, where phi b is the bulk potential. In other words, you see on the gate side, this is Ec of n plus, and on the substrate side, this is the mid gap, and this is phi b. This phi b is dependent on doping concentration, correct, bulk potential. So, phi ms is really this, which is half the band gap, which is let us say 0.56, and phi b. Okay. So, it is minus of 0.56 plus phi b, that comes here. 2 phi b is a positive quantity, 2 phi b is a positive quantity, but little less than this, because you see phi b can never be 0.56, right, phi b is always less than 0.56. So, this minus this will be a small negative quantity, and overpowering that you will have another positive quantity, and eventually you end up with 0.2, 0.3, whatever threshold voltage depending on your doping concentration and oxide thickness, right. This is for N channel. Now, P channel, very interestingly, let us say if you do the right doping and all, let us say your VT of N is 0.3 volt, let us say. Now, you see what happens to P channel VT. VTP is again the same equation, except phi ms is going to be positive, because now phi m for p channel transistor is p plus, okay, which is 4.05 plus full band gap, okay, because ev is here, correct, the Fermi level will be here for the pmos. And what is the work function here? It is the phi b, let me draw this so that there is no confusion, right. So, here this is ev, valence band, right? This is P plus. Fermi level is on the gate close to the valence band, right? That is why we call it P plus. On the other hand, substrate is n-type. This is mid gap and this is your Fermi level and this is phi b and this is half the band gap, 0.56, let us say. So, phi m is larger than phi s. So, phi m s is a positive quantity, correct, and phi m s is positive 0.56 plus phi b. Okay. Now, what happens here? The band bending is minus, I mean this is a negative quantity. Now, it is a p channel transistor, bands are bending opposite. Okay. So, minus times 2 phi b is plus this still gives you a small positive quantity, and again you have this q d which is a opposite charge and that will also be a negative quantity, and all that put together will give a negative v t which is almost same as this positive v t for n channel. That is excellent, right. So, in other words, your V t for P will become equal to minus 0.3 volt. This happened simply because we had dual work function gate. This would never happen if you have identical gate for N channel and P channel. Let us suppose that the gates for N channel were, you know, N plus. For P channel they were also n plus, then you will get a huge negative number for V t, okay, right, because this you will not have a positive quantity, this will also be a negative quantity because this is sitting here at n plus, okay, and similarly, you know, you will not be able to get an appropriate V t matching for n and p channel transistors. So, this is a problem, right, and hence the dual gate technology was excellent, right. And as soon as we figured out how to, you know, do this polysilicon and dope polysilicon heavily n plus p plus, we migrated to the dual gate polysilicon technology because you get this and as well as self aligned transistors, correct, two very important metrics. So, why are we talking about metal gate today? Okay. If this is why in the first place we moved from you know, metal gate technology to polysilicon gate technology, right. Well, there is a reason for that. The reason also becomes very clear to you if you look at what we have been doing so far, right. If you look at the transistor, you see this gate length, this is my gate, right, and this gate length has come down from in microns, tens of microns, today we are talking of less than 50 nanometer. Let us for a minute look at this direction, not the gate length direction, but the width direction. In other words, if you were to look at the top view of this transistor, okay, and let us say this is the width, okay, and this is where you will have a gate contact, this will be gate. And you will have source here, drain here, and so on and so forth. This is shrinking, right? This is shrinking to 30 nanometers, and so on and so forth, from where it was micron, okay. But you see, the widths in any circuit are dependent on how much current you want from the transistor, right? If you want more current, you scale the width, you increase the width, right. So, width is not necessarily in your control. You make the lengths as small as possible, so the transistor becomes fast transistor, because the distance between source and drain is very, very small. Now, if you for a minute look at in this direction, what will happen? The signal from a previous stage will come on to this contact, and this signal should propagate along this direction, correct. Now, let us look at that, and how does it look? You know, that essentially looks like you know, a very something like this, right. Okay. So, the signal is coming at one edge, let us say this is where the signal has come, and the signal has to propagate along this. And you see, this is not a superconductor, right? I mean, this is after all you know, some material, polysilicon, okay, you have doped it very heavily, But nonetheless, you still have some resistivity, you know, its resistivity could be a few ohm per micrometer, ohm per square kind of resistivity, okay. So, what it means is that as we start shrinking this, what is that? That is channel length, right. As we are starting to shrink it, that is one aspect. What is happening simultaneously? The frequencies are increasing. Right, we are no longer talking of megahertz, we are talking of gigahertz, right. So, at this large frequency, this will start acting as a transmission line, okay, because it has a finite resistance, the resistance is not you know 0 as I said, and there is a capacitance obviously, because that is a gate insulator capacitance. So, this is essentially an RC delay, okay. And this RC delay is not negligible for two reasons, as I mentioned again. This R is increasing. Why is R increasing? If we were to look at your resistance, you have decreased the channel length, correct. Earlier, when the channel length was long, there was what is the area of cross section for the current flow here? That is the thickness, correct, and the length. That is the area that is available. This length is decreasing. So, area of cross section is decreasing because of that. And not only that, we have also scaled the gate stack. We have not been using very thick gates. We have also scaled that. So, even thickness has decreased, right. So, as a result of that, this resistance has really gone up like this, okay, polysilicon gate, okay. And so much so that because of this large resistance, the RC times have become comparable to reciprocal of the frequency of the signal of interest. I am using this microprocessor at you know few tens of gigahertz. Reciprocal of that is you know it depends on that will dictate how much RC delay you can tolerate, that is less than nanoseconds, okay. So, this is a serious problem, right. So, the problem is the gate resistance. Gate resistance has become a serious problem, okay, right. When we say gate resistance as I mentioned, for the signal to propagate, you know, from one end of the gate to the other end of the gate. What it means is that when the signal comes here, the transistor will slowly start turning on from this edge. So, current front moves from this edge, and eventually, when the signal reaches this, you will have whole transistor conducting, which is not good, right. Your current is much lower than what should have been for certain duration of RC delay of this gate, right. And hence, we want to replace this polysilicon gate. What is the solution? You convert this material into something which has much lower resistivity. And what is that lower resistivity? Metal, okay. This is one thing, but there was another equally important problem that came about, you know, that was to do with the following, right. You remember, polysilicon when it is deposited, it is intrinsic, and it had to be converted into either N plus or P plus by doping. If you do not dope it, it will not have a low resistivity. So, that resulted in one more problem, which I will again briefly discuss, and that is called polysilicon depletion effect. Right. So, what it essentially means is that you have this polysilicon, let us say it is 100 nanometer thick, you need to implant and diffuse, correct. Look at the fine balance that we have to strike here. How do you dope the polysilicon completely? You see, polysilicon, which is intrinsic to begin with, I will call it I for intrinsic, should be converted into N plus. For this to convert to N plus, this whole region from this point all the way to this point should have very heavy arsenic doping, okay. How do you do that? One of the two ways, right. Either you implant very deep, If you cannot deep implant very deep, you diffuse far. You have implanted only this point, let do a huge dose implant, diffuse it down so that it will come down. But the problem is the following, right? It is the same implant that is going to the gate and the source and drain. So if you want to dope the whole thing, your source and junction could be at least as deep as this, because it is exactly same process. It is not going to be a different process. That is the beauty, right? It is a self-aligned transistor. It is the same process that is defining it N plus and N plus source drain. But deep source drains are not good, because they would in turn result in bad short channel effect, dibble and so on and so forth that we have talked about. This coupling volume has to decrease, correct? That is what we have discussed quite extensively. That is one thing. The other thing that happened was, sometimes when you actually did this, somehow let us say you did this, this oxide that you had was ultra thin, right? 1 nanometer is what we were talking about, SiO2. When you have such a thin oxide, you know, these dopants can also diffuse through the oxide, okay? Especially so with boron, because boron is so light as opposed to arsenic. In fact, in literature you will see this problem called boron penetration. What it means is that the boron can easily penetrate through this ultra thin 1 nanometer. It is as if it is non-existent there. Okay. So now, you do not want the boron to come, boron will be in a p-channel transistor. Okay. In a n-channel transistor, we can talk of arsenic penetration, but that is not big a problem. But in a p-channel transistor, it is complement of this, as you know. Right. So then we are talking of this is made P plus, this is made P plus, and your gate is also made P plus. This boron will come here, that will make this P plus. That is not good. You do not want boron to come in the channel, correct? You have actually a N well here. You do not want that N to convert into a P type, you see. So invariably you had to end up with the situation where the polysilicon very close to gate oxide will not be as heavily doped. In other words, if I were to look at the doping profile, let me call it, you know, this is what I call x axis, right? This is what I have been calling y axis. Let me call it, you know, x equal to 0 here for just the sake of this plot. And this is T poly, which indicates polysilicon thickness, okay? So then what you probably will end up is something like this. Okay, x equal to 0 here, x equal to T poly. Ideally, correct, this is where your gate oxide starts, remember that. Ideally, you want this whole thing to be doped very heavy, let us say 10 to the 21 per centimeter cube arsenic or boron. But I cannot do that, right? For one thing, the junctions could be deep, for the other thing, you can end up with having this penetration. So invariably what you will probably end up is something like this, because you are afraid to push it too far. So the region very close to your gate oxide will be depleted, and this is what we mean by polysilicon depletion. There is not as many dopants. What is the impact of this? The impact is twofold. One, obviously the gate resistance will increase even more, because the plot that I had shown you earlier of R versus L is assuming that whole polysilicon is doped, okay, right? Let us say that corresponds to this case. But now if you have this case, you may have something like this, because this region is not doped, you see, and hence the resistivity will increase in that region. That is one. But there is even more serious problem with this, and that is, if you look at the vertical direction, okay, what happens now in vertical direction is, this is your gate, okay. You see, this polysilicon, we used to only consider the gate oxide capacitance here and the silicon capacitance, assuming that the whole thing is like a conductor. But now there is huge depletion here, which means there will be effectively another series capacitance. So this is what is called polysilicon depletion capacitance. So whenever a new capacitance comes in series, the total capacitance goes down as opposed to resistances in series. Okay. So what means it means is that your gate coupling to the channel degrades. Your gate cannot effectively couple to the channel because now it is C aux in series with C depletion. Okay, that will certainly be much lower than C aux. Okay. So your transistor will have lower current. Right. So these were real problems, you know, we were stuck with these problems, and that is why we had to change it to a metal gate technology. Okay. So just to recap that, you know, the resistance which increased the RC delay was not desirable, and polydepletion effect was another undesirable effect, right. Both this forced us to change polysilicon to metal gate. But now, the challenge for now is how do you make a metal gate transistor which is self-aligned? Because we have been doing self-aligned transistor, we do not want to go back to our old transistor which has a huge overlap, because now we are talking of huge frequencies of operation. So, I must get self-aligned transistors, that is the challenge, right. So, I want to get metal gate self-aligned transistor. So, there are, you know, possibly two ways, you know, one can get. There is what is called a disposable gate process, and there is another called, it is called abbreviated as FUSY, fully silicided gate or okay. Of course, this is more complicated process, and today we have in manufacturing all the 65, 45 nanometer technologies are actually using disposable gate process. We will see what is disposable gate process in a minute. Then the first question to ask is, do you want to do a single metal gate or double metal gate? Okay. Now, this is an important consideration. Remember, I told you dual polysilicon gate technology was excellent because you got N plus kind of a work function on NMOS on the gate side, and P plus kind of a work function for PMOS on the gate side, correct, which was dual work function. So, if I need to have a matching VTs, I must have two metal gates, right. So, we call them, you know, NMOS, you know, NMOS work function metals and PMOS work function metals. NMOS work function metals. So, you see metals have different work functions depending on which metals you are looking at. For example, if you look at aluminum, zirconium, they all have low work function. Aluminum is 4.1, zirconium is about 4.2. That is very close to N plus, because N plus is 4.05, that is the electron affinity for silicon conduction band, right, N plus, that is where the Fermi level is. There are others such as platinum, okay, and you know a few others, you know, gold also has large work function, and a few other metals are there, like they are all 5.2, 5.3, 5.1, which is what is there in P plus, because P plus is 4.05 electron affinity plus one band gap, which is 1.1, correct. So, the P plus work function should be like 5.2 EV. So, there are different kinds of metals that are available. Okay. There was also a proposal for a while is that, look, if I have to use two metals as opposed to polysilicon, polysilicon was an intrinsic polysilicon which was deposited and then converted to N plus during N channel implant and P plus during P channel implant. But here I need to have two different deposition process and two different lithography process. You know, I need to first deposit aluminum and etch it off in PMOS regions and retain only in NMOS regions, and then block NMOS region, deposit some other metal and, you know, again pattern it, more complicated, right, which required two deposition, two etching, two lithography to pattern the gate, as opposed to a single deposition, okay, and single etching process, okay. And there was a proposal called you know, mid gap metal gate, okay. There are some metals, you know, which have work function neither 4.1 nor like 5.2, somewhere in between, like, you know, 4.6, 4.7 EV. So the idea was that, you know, you have a single metal gate whose work function is at the middle of the band gap, right. So you compromise both N channel and P channel transistors identically, okay. So you would probably still be able to get matching VT, but VT will certainly be compromised, okay. So that was not really a usable solution. So what we are been doing today is double gate, double metal gate using disposable gate process technique, and double metal gate, one with NMOS and one with PMOS work function. As you know, the work function is very important because VT will not be obtained properly otherwise, okay. So now how do we do this now? Okay, so let us look at okay, disposable gate process. So what we do here is that we just go through the usual process of making a polysilicon gate transistor. That is, you have N well or P well, whatever it is, you actually do a gate oxide, do polysilicon deposition, although I want to get metal gate, right, but for the time being I do polysilicon and pattern polysilicon wherever I want to have the gates, on N channel region as well as P channel regions, okay. Then do the source drain implant. When I do the source drain implant, polysilicon is sitting here, correct. So it will still give me self aligned transistor, correct. So in other words, I will get, let us say, N plus, and this also becomes N plus, let us say. Now what I will do, the same similar thing will be done for P plus also, okay. Now after this, what I do is that I deposit an insulator on top everywhere, okay. Let us say you deposit extra insulator and then etch it off. Let us say I deposit SiO2 and polish this SiO2 such that I will end up with all the SiO2 in this region and this region, okay. Okay. And in this region, you know, this gate is exposed. So what will happen here then is that, oops, okay, I guess, okay, right. So this is SiO2 here, SiO2 here, correct. Similarly in P channel regions also. Now what I do, I have SiO2 here and I have silicon here. I can use right edge chemistry and I can get rid of this polysilicon gate, remove it completely, okay. So when you remove it, you will end up with a cavity there, correct. Okay, remember, source and drains are already formed, and they are formed self-aligned to this edge, correct? And they are formed self-aligned to this edge because this polysilicon was a placeholder. It was just sitting there to define my self-aligned transistor. Now the polysilicon's job is done because I don't want to use it eventually in my circuit because it will have huge resistance. So etch it off. Etch it off selectively by creating a structure like this. Now fill this region with whatever metal that you want in n channel region. Let's say aluminum. Right? Of course you know you do a lithography, you make sure that it doesn't go to p region. All your n regions will get this. And similarly you do another set of process, meaning only the deposition. Opening and cavity formation is already done. It is done at the same time anyway, right? You know, you have another cavity here for p-channel transistor. This is a p-channel transistor, p plus, and there is a cavity here. This is SiO2 and this is also SiO2. This is also SiO2. And you fill this cavity with a different metal. This will be a p-MOS work function metal and this will be an n-MOS work function metal, okay? More complex process, that is true, okay, because you know you had to add the polysilicon, you had to etch it away, fill it differently in n region, fill it, well you deposit everywhere but you know retain it here, pattern lithography and retain it here and similarly here and so on and so forth, right. So okay, I'll just take back what I said. You don't do lithography here, you just do chemical mechanical polishing, okay, right. I mean you don't necessarily do lithography, okay, but nonetheless you know you can you know do this process such that metal is there and source drain was before metal, so you don't have to anneal it at high temperature, correct. So there is no danger of metal melting. But because I had that dummy polysilicon, I got self-aligned transistor and hence the name disposable gate process. There was a gate, polysilicon gate, and that was only a placeholder and that was disposed of subsequently. That is how I got this metal gate here, perfectly self-aligned transistor, right. This is one way of doing that and this is what is done very extensively today. Well, there are a lot of issues, you know, I sort of filled in that region so easily with you know the marker pen here, but really you know you will have to make sure that there is a huge cavity here, the metal should deposit conformally everywhere, okay, and you don't want to end up with a cavity here where metal is not deposited properly, okay. There is a lot of process optimization that goes in, but you have to do that because there is no other way you can build transistors today. If you are talking of transistors less than 45 nanometer, you take for granted that the process is certainly more complex, but that is worth it. Only when you do all that complicated process, you will be able to, you know, get a very well behaved transistor, okay. So what is the implication of this? You know, we started off with the main problem that we had, right? That is my R versus length, okay. You know, it looked like this, you see. If I go to metal gate, okay, it would look like this. So this is the metal gate, whereas this is the polysilicon gate. Especially where you are shrinking length very significantly, metal gate will outperform polysilicon gate very significantly. What is the second option? Second option is called fusee or fully silicided gate. Okay. Fine. So what do we do here? as the name suggests, the idea is to exploit silicidation process to create somewhat like a metal gate transistor. What is the silicidation process? If you remember, I had explained this to you earlier in one of my lectures, and that is, I told you that your transistor looks like this. There will be a spacer here, there will be a spacer here, and eventually the source and drain contacts will come here. You will have a shallow extension here and then a deep source drain here, correct? I told you that this regions, we convert them into a combination of metal and silicon or silicide. You deposit a metal, anneal it at high temperature, and there is a reaction between metal and silicon, and you end up with the silicide, correct? So here, this region, and this region, this all gets converted to silicide, okay. So the idea of fully silicided technology is that you, let's say I'm doing a titanium silicide, you convert this whole region into titanium silicide. So strictly speaking, we shouldn't call it metal gate, it's more like a silicide gate. Okay, right. In other words, it's a combination of titanium and silicon. Silicon which is either N plus doped or P plus doped. Okay, very interestingly, when you convert a silicide, the work function of this silicide, tie silicide, is governed by what is your initial work function of that silicon, right? Whether you had a N plus silicon or a P plus silicon. So in all N channel regions, you would have N plus gates, correct? And that becomes an N plus tie silicide. And in P channel region, you have a P plus tie silicide, because you had a boron heavy doping, right? Here you had a arsenic heavy doping. Okay. So as a result of that, you have been able to get somewhat like a metal gate. Okay. It's not quite metal gate, because this is not comparable to having an ideal metal gate, right? In other words, you, if you were to interpose another curve, what you will probably see is that, you know, you may get something like this for a fusee, fully silicided technology. Fully silicided technology is certainly better than polysilicon gate. Certainly, it is not as good as a metal gate. What is the advantage here? The advantage is simply that the process is not very complex. You see, I do not have to do a disposing of the gate, etching of the gate, and then doing another deposition for N like gate and another deposition for P like gate, and so on and so forth, right. So the advantage of a fusee process right, simple process flow. But there is a disadvantage also, right? As you know, double metal gate that we are talking about. And also the whole thing has to be silicided. You know, if you can't silicide, if part of that silicon is left with, then that is also not a good thing, right? Because, you know, that region will be a high resistivity region, right? So your total resistance will also increase because of that region, right? So as a result of that, you know, fully silicided gate is a theoretical possibility. You will see that lot of literature exists wherein people have demonstrated it is doable, and you get reasonable threshold voltage matching for N and P, because it works as a dual metal function or work function gate. However, because it does not improve the RC delay, as much as a double metal gate technology, you know, it is not really a practically implementable technology. Okay. So, that is what we essentially do with respect to metal gate technology. In fact, today all technology today, the state of the art technology today, as I said, you know, anything less than 65 nanometer CMOS technology is a metal gate and high K. As we discussed in the last lectures, we also have a high K gate dielectric, right. High K gate dielectric and metal gates sort of go hand in hand, you know, they happen simultaneously in terms of replacing the silicon oxide as a gate insulating material, and also in terms of replacing polysilicon gate as your gate electrode. Okay. The best thing about a metal gate is that there is absolutely no polysilicon depletion issue, apart from the resistance issue that we talked about, RC delay and all that, right. So, the poly depletion effect is completely eliminated, right. You get the best gate coupling, right. So, you know, which means the best gate coupling to channel. Okay. And hence invariably, you know, you will see that your high K with metal gate as opposed to polysilicon gate will certainly have much better on current of a transistor as opposed to a polysilicon gate transistor. Okay. Fine. So, well, let me then summarize the discussions that we had today. You know, MOSFET, as the name suggests, is you know, a metal gate FET. That is how we started building a FET, but when we started building an FET with metal gate, we had to resort to a gate last process and source drain first process, because otherwise metal would melt during the source drain annealing process, right. And hence the gate had to be defined using photolithography process, and you ended up with huge overlap, gate overlapping source and drain and parasitic capacitances. And that is how we sort of quickly migrated to polysilicon gate technology, although we continue to call them as MOSFETs. Its M here was a misnomer really, okay. For last 3-4 decades, M was misnomer because it was not really metal gate. It was a polysilicon gate technology, highly doped polysilicon. The greatest advantage then was, most importantly, you had self aligned transistor, and you also had this you know, N plus and P plus kind of a dual work functions for your N channel and P channel transistor, which resulted in very well matched threshold voltages for NMOS and PMOS. But as we started shrinking the gate length, you know, at about 65 nanometer, the resistivity of the gate started really influencing the RC delay for the propagation through the gate electrode, and that is when we were forced to replace the polysilicon gate with the metal gate. But then the challenge was really to get the metal gate using a self-aligned transistor flow, right. And that is how we sort of resorted to having a disposable gate process, wherein we continued the, you know, best practices of polysilicon gate technology, wherein polysilicon was just a placeholder, right, to define that self-aligned transistor. Subsequently, you etch out the polysilicon and you define different metal gates for N channel and P channel regions, and hence you get the self-aligned transistor as well as the very well matched VTs, because I am using a double metal gate process. Okay. So, we will stop here and we will continue in the next class.